Hare Krishna everyone, welcome to Once Upon a Time. We are covering Dashavatara series, the 10 important avatars of the Supreme Lord Krishna, Keshava, Dhritta, all the different rupas, avatars, incarnations. So we have already covered about Matsyavatara, the fish incarnation, Kurmavatara, the tortoise incarnation, Varaha Avatara, the beautiful boar incarnation, Narasimha Avatara, the half man, half lion incarnation. We also talked about Vamana Avatara, the dwarf Brahmana incarnation of the Lord, and the three different Ramas, Parashurama, the one carrying the axe and annihilating all the unrighteous Kshatriyas around the globe 21 times. And then Lord Rama, Sri Ramachandra of Ayodhya, and then Lord Balarama, who carries the plow, who happens to be the elder brother of the Supreme Lord Krishna, the very first expansion of the Supreme Lord. Now moving forward, the ninth incarnation, which did not happen in other yugas, but it happened in this very yuga, the beginning of Kali Yuga. Just like in the example of Lord Varaha, we talked about two different Varaha incarnations, the white boar incarnation and the red boar incarnation at two different times. In a similar fashion, when we talk about the incarnation of the Supreme Lord as Buddha, in today's episode, we will talk about two different Buddha incarnations. In fact, I don't know if we can necessarily call the second as the incarnation, but the very first time when the Supreme Lord comes, like when Jayadeva Goswami is talking about Nindasi Yajna Vider Ahaha Shruti Jatam Sadaya Hridaya Darshita Pashu Ghatam Keshavadrita Buddha Sharira Jaya Jagadisha Hare. So the Buddha that Jayadeva Goswami is describing here in Dashavatara series, this Buddha appeared around 1800 BC before Christ. So it was in the early parts of the beginning of Kali Yuga. And why did this particular incarnation appear? As he is rightly pointing out, Nindasi Yajna Vider Aha Shruti Jatam. Shruti means the Vedas. So as part of the Vedic injunctions, there is some allowance for people to kill animals to satisfy their tongues, but in a very, very restricted way. And also not only in a restricted way, but whoever engages in animal killing will also suffer for it. But what happened around this time was, Yudhishthir Maharaj had gone, and then after him Parikshit Maharaj, he was cursed by the Brahmana boy and he left, and then after him his son Janamejaya. So they had established a solid foundation of dharma, but when through the onslaught of Kali Yuga, in the beginning of Kali Yuga, the dharma was waning. And it came to a very abominable, time, place and circumstance where people would just decry. In the name of Yajna, in the name of sacrifice, they took undue advantage of this allowance in the Shruti, in the Vedas for animal killing, and left, right and center, there was onslaught of animal killing. You know, that is why he is saying Sadaya Hridaya Darshita Pashugatam, Pashugatam. There was merciless slaughtering of the animals. And in order to establish peace, in order to establish non-violence as an overriding principle, Lord comes in the form of Buddha. And what did Buddha do? He decried the Vedas. Why? Because these people were giving the example, the proof, the evidence of Vedas. See, Vedas are telling we can kill animals as a sacrifice. So they were misusing that. So what did Buddha do? He decried. He said, you just forget about Vedas and everything. You just give up Vedas. Then what should you do? Ahimso paramo dharmaha. Ahimsa, non-violence is the greatest principle of dharma. So you simply become non-violent, you stop killing the animals, and that's it. That will be okay. And this Buddha, you know, research shows that he appeared about 1800 BC before Christ, like I said. And Srimad Bhagavatam, interestingly, was, although it was composed 5000 years ago, it is predicting something that's going to happen in the future. That's the power of this Amala Purana. Srimad Bhagavatam, it predicts not only Buddha Avatara, then the Kalki Avatara, which has still not happened, will happen, but it's the 10th incarnation, and we are going to go really deep into that in our next episode, and Bhagavatam is predicting even that. That's the power of the scriptures. You can know about the past, present, and the future, everything as it is in the complete truth. So this particular Buddha who has been predicted, his appearance is predicted in Srimad Bhagavatam and Dashavatara Sotra. It has been sung by Jayadeva Goswami in Gita Govinda. So he appeared in a place called Bodh Gaya. His mother's name was Anjana, and he is the Vishnu Avatara Buddha. But then, several centuries later, about 560 BC before Christ, there was another appearance of a great enlightened being who is also called Buddha. This is the Siddhartha Buddha, Gautama Buddha. But he is not the incarnation of Vishnu who is predicted in Srimad Bhagavatam. And he is not the Buddha that Jayadev Goswami is talking about in Dashavatara Stotra. So we should be very clear, there are two different Buddhas. So now let's talk a little bit about Gautama Buddha. So in the border of Bihar and Nepal, at the time it was called the Magadha region, there was the capital of Magadha region called Kapilavastu. And in Kapilavastu, there was a king by the name Suddhodana, and his wife was Maya Devi. So this king Suddhodana and his queen Maya Devi, they were childless for about 20 years, and that's a long time. So after a really long time, Maya Devi was, expecting. She conceived Buddha. In fact, just before, of course, he was not called Buddha at the time. They called him Siddhartha. Buddha means the enlightened one, which he will attain enlightenment 35 years later after his birth. So it is said that Maya Devi, just before delivering the baby boy, she had a dream, and in that dream, she happened to see a white elephant with 6 tusks. Usually the elephant has 2 tusks, right? This elephant had 6 tusks, and it was a white elephant, and she dreamt like as though this elephant was entering her womb. And right after that, she conceived Siddhartha and gave birth to Siddhartha, and Suddhodana's joy knew no bounds. On one hand, it's a great celebratory event that after 20 years, they gave birth to this child. But unfortunately, Maya Devi passed away during the labor, after delivering the baby. And it was his aunt, Maya Devi's sister, Gautami, who played a big maternal role, motherly role in raising Siddhartha. And that is why Siddhartha is also called Gautama, because he was raised by Gautami. And, because he was a king and all that, Suddhodana, he wants to know about the future of the child so he can plan accordingly. So he called one great rishi, Asit Rishi. And Asit Rishi, he had a long beard and he carried the child, Siddhartha, on his lap, and the baby was playing on his lap. And Suddhodana Maharaj was asking, can you please predict the future of my son? And as this child was playing, he happened to put his feet in the beard of Asit Rishi, and Asit Rishi was trying to get his foot from his beard entanglement. And then at that time, he sees that so many holy auspicious signs, marks are there on the footprint, on the foot of this child. And seeing that, he predicted that either this child will become a great Chakravarti, emperor, or he will become a great renunciant, sannyasi, one or the other. So it was quite a trauma for Suddhodana, you know, for a king to get to know that his son will become a renunciant. So he wanted more confirmation, so he brought 8 different astrologers to his kingdom and had everybody predict the future of the child. 7 out of the 8 astrologers, all of them predicted the same thing that Asit Rishi had said, that this child will either become a Chakravarti or he will become a renunciant. But only one of them, one of those 8 astrologers by the name Kaudinya, he said, I differ from the prediction of all these other astrologers. He said he will not become a Chakravarti. This child has one and only thing in his destination, that he is going to become a great renunciant. He will become an enlightened Buddha. Buddha itself means enlightened. And he says that I myself will become a disciple of this great renunciant, sannyasi. So from this moment onward, King Suddhodana made sure that Siddhartha would not come in touch, experience, witness any kind of pain or suffering. Because not only these astrologers predicted what I just said, but they also said he will give up everything the moment he sees some suffering. So because that was the trigger point, King Suddhodana made sure that Siddhartha was never allowed to freely roam about and interact with anybody he wanted. He had to always be within the walls of the palace, confines of the palace, but Suddhodana had built him one exclusive palace for the summer season, another exclusive palace for the winter season, another one for the monsoon season. Whatever that was available across the world for any kind of sense pleasure, it was there at the disposal of Siddhartha. No old people were seen inside the palace. No sick people were allowed to be, you know, seen by Siddhartha. No death news, nobody dead, nothing. So all possible arrangements were made to make sure that Siddhartha never sees any kind of pain or suffering. And it worked out quite well. Siddhartha was having a great time, and all kinds of education, everything that was done within the confines of the palace, academic education, martial education, everything, you name it, he got it. But he didn't have to step out. At the age of 16, they found a very suitable girl and gave her in marriage to Siddhartha, called Yashodhara. She was an embodiment of amazing jewel-like qualities, very beautiful, very chaste, very loyal. So Siddhartha married Yashodhara, and up until the age of 29, you know, he was like a great householder. And Siddhartha, when he expressed interest that he wants to go out also and see, that he's never had a chance to go out, he's almost about to be a king, he should also be able to go and see his kingdom, King Suddhodana made sure that only once he would go out. But at that time, during that trip, the king made sure that there was no old person, there was no sick person, there was not a dead body, nobody grieving, mourning, and also he would not come across any renunciants with saffron robes, you know, who are sannyasis. So Siddhartha did go out, but in this kind of a tight arrangement, and of course he had a great experience. He wanted to go again, and the king made sure again the same kind of arrangement was made. So a few times the same thing happened, and the king was pretty assured by now that it's okay, you know, my son is not going to leave the kingdom. He's already experienced, you know, such bliss, such joy and all that. He's going to become a king and no problem, he's not going to become a sannyasi. Alas, this is exactly how many a times parents do so many things with the wish, you know, with the intention of making their child become something. But we see time and again, in spite of the best interests of the parents, the children will become what they are destined to be. This is not to say that the parents should not perform their duty and do the best possible thing. It's only to say that you can't make them something which they are not destined to become. We can only do our duty, but the result is not in our hands. It's in the hands of the Supreme Lord. So similarly, Siddhartha, once, without telling his father, he spoke to his friend who was also his charioteer, his name was, let me get that, Chunda, and he had this special favorite horse called Kantak. So Siddhartha told Chunda that, you know, I want to go once, but this time I don't want to tell my father, it's just you and me, we will take Kantak and we will go. Chunda said, okay, fine, and they decided a date for that, and then he was out roaming around in Kapilavastu. And first time in his life, Siddhartha witnessed an old person, wrinkled skin, hunched back. He could barely see, he could barely hear. First time in his life, he saw an old person. And he asked Chunda, why is this man like this? Why is he not walking straight? Why is his skin all wrinkled? Chunda explained that, you know, because he's an old man. Siddhartha asked, what is that? Will I also become old? Will I also become like this? Chunda said, yes. It's only a matter of time that everybody will grow old. And then as they went forward in their journey, Buddha, of course he's still not Buddha, he's not become Buddha, he is Siddhartha, he witnesses a sick person. They were crying out in pain, oh, please help me, I'm going through such tremendous pain, wailing and crying. Siddhartha heard the shrieks of pain and he asked Chunda, who is that who is calling out for help? And Chunda explained, this person is having some kind of a disease, he's in pain, that's why he's suffering and calling out like that. And Siddhartha asked, will I also fall sick? Will I also get this disease? So Chunda said, you may or may not get the same disease, but nevertheless, anybody who's taken birth at some point or the other, they do get some diseases. It's common, it's natural. So Siddhartha was thinking, so he has experienced, he's witnessed an old person, he saw a sick person, and as they were going forward, there were a bunch of people who were just beating their chest and crying bitterly, weeping. So Siddhartha asked, what happened? Why are these people crying? And Chunda explained that, you know, their family member has just passed away. So they are mourning his death. They can't take the separation. Siddhartha said, what is death? And Chunda explained to him. And Siddhartha asked, will I also die? Chunda said, yes. Everybody will when the time comes. Siddhartha was becoming more and more, you know, he was going deep into contemplation. And then finally on their journey, Siddhartha sees a man who is in orange robes. He's just sitting and doing his meditation. Very, very simple. And Siddhartha asks, who is this man? Doesn't he have a home? Doesn't he have his family members? Why is he like this? On the bank of the river, he's just sitting and meditating. Who is he? So Chunda explained that he's a renunciant, he's a sannyasi. He has, you know, turned his back towards all the sufferings of the world and he wants to attain liberation. He wants to escape from the cycle of birth and death. He is working on attaining liberation, mukti, moksha. That's it. So after that, Siddhartha was taken back to the palace and he simply couldn't even sleep. Day and night, for many, many days after that, he went into deep pondering. He was contemplating on all this, these hard realities of life. How contrarily, you know, exact opposite thing in today's world. Here is Siddhartha who just saw these things once in his life. And he's contemplating on the realities, on the truths of life. And here we are, since our birth up until now, we are seeing so many old people, we are seeing so many people fall sick, we are seeing so many people, you know, bidding adieu and leaving their body. We see so many sannyasis, but somehow we are not contemplating so deeply on the realities of life. In fact, it's the exact opposite. If we happen to talk about death, people will say, death, no, 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 shubh bolo, shubh bolo. Talk something auspicious. Don't talk about something so morbid like death and old age. So many things. $1 billion of industry, billions of dollar industries. Industries are run just to make people look young. Cosmetics, surgeries, dyeing the hair, fixing the teeth, tightening the skin, you name it. Why? Because they don't want to face to face, realize that yes, growing old is fact of life. They just want to cover it as much as possible. And especially the more you go to the West, to grow old it seems like as though it's a sin. You have to do everything possible in your capacity to look young. Crazy. What illusion. And when somebody dies also, there is somebody called undertaker. Who is an undertaker? His whole business is when they bring a dead body and they place it in that coffin, he will dress up the dead body. They will get the dead body cleaned up and, you know, they will make him wear a nice suit. They will shave off his beard and, you know, comb his hair, make everything neat and tidy. And in fact, they will even pull his cheeks and put some clips this way, that way, left and right, as though, you know, to give an impression to people like this person died while he was, you know, having a smiling face, like he happily left the world. Height of illusion, really. So this is the type of world that we are living in such illusion. We want to deny death, we want to deny old age, we want to deny diseases, we want to continue on like as though we are going to live here forever. But on the other hand, somebody like Siddhartha, just one encounter with death, disease and old age, and he is in such deep contemplation. And that's it. He thought, if I'm also going to grow old, if I'm also going to die, if I'm also going to fall sick, then what is the use of all this enjoyment? It's like somebody is telling you to eat gulab jamun, but they have a gun to your head. How can you enjoy? So he's thinking, if I'm going to die, if I'm going to grow old, if I'm going to fall sick, then what's the point in enjoying all this royal luxuries? Now this is intelligence. That is why Krishna also in Bhagavad Gita called Janma, Mrityu, Jara, Vyadi, Dukkha, Doshanu, Darshanam. These are the real problems of life. So what conclusion did Siddhartha come to? He left his home. In fact, it is historians say that his wife Yashodhara had just given birth to Rahul, that beautiful baby boy. And Siddhartha, it is said that he didn't even go to the room when Yashodhara was sleeping in the night along with the baby boy Rahul. He thought that if he looks at them, then he will be overcome by emotions and attachment and he will not be able to take this grave step of leaving everything. So he does not even go to see them. He just talks to his friend, like I said, Chunda, and he says that, you know, middle of the night we are supposed to leave. And that's exactly what he does. He just leaves the royal palace, family, his, he was supposed to be the next king, all that, he just left. And in fact, it is said that even the horse, the Kantak horse, when it was taking Siddhartha, it did not even make the noise of its hoofprint. You know, the tuck, 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 tuck. Horses when they are running. So nobody got to know. So Siddhartha left the palace. He went and sat under Bodhi tree. And for several days, initially, he takes up intense austerity, so much so that You know, after a few days, when he touches, he places his palm on his stomach, on his belly, and put the other palm on the back, it was like almost both of them were touching. Intense austerity. He was torturing his body with no food, no water. And there was a Mataji, there was a lady who came to ask him something, and something got triggered in his head. And then he realized that, you know, too much sense enjoyment is also not good, and too much sense torture is also not good. So he said, I will choose a Madhyama Marga, a middle path. In fact, Krishna also says in 6th chapter, Yukta Hara Viharasya Yukta Cheshtasu. He also says everything should be Yukta, you know, moderation. No extremes, not too much, not too little. So at the age of, you know, 45 days, he continuously meditates upon the Supreme Lord, and under this Bodhi tree, he attains enlightenment. And that's how Siddhartha became Buddha, Gautama became Gautama Buddha, the enlightened one. And after this, at the age of 35, when he attained enlightenment, he starts preaching. And anybody who came in touch with Buddha would get enlightened, you know, their hearts will be transformed, and they would become bhikkhus. Like full time, they would surrender unto Buddha and serve him in every capacity possible. And this news happened to reach his father, Suddhodana. And Suddhodana sent one team of people to convince Buddha to come back to the royal palace, and Buddha would never budge. Not only he budges, that first team who came to actually take Siddhartha Gautama Buddha back, they even did not go back. Even they became his disciples. So like this, 2, 3, 4, 9 teams Suddhodana kept sending as messengers, and all the 9 teams of people who came, everybody became disciples of Buddha, and they would not even return back. This was the power of Gautama Buddha. And then Suddhodana sent Gautama Buddha's younger brother, and he came, and Buddha agreed, okay, I will come. But then when Suddhodana had arranged a big elaborate royal feast, Buddha along with his disciples, they chose to beg on the streets of Kapilavastu and not partake in the feast, and Suddhodana was broken hearted by this. And he went and asked his son Siddhartha, Gautama Buddha, how can you do this? You're a Kshatriya. You're not supposed to be begging. You're supposed to be ruling. You're a leader. You're a king. But Gautama Buddha said, that's my past life. But right now, I'm a bhikkhu. You know, bhikshu, bhikkhu. He says, it's okay. Now, right now, my duty is to eat only that which I get in alms by begging. So this is how Siddhartha became Gautama Buddha, and up until the age of 80, for 45 years, from the age of 35 to 80, he preached extensively Buddhism. He had many thousands of disciples. There is also that famous Angulimala story that we have read back in the school, at least I read it, I don't know about you. So there was a very arrogant disciple of some teacher, and the teacher in Guru Dakshina asked him to get 1000 fingers because the student happened to be very arrogant. He wanted to teach him a lesson. So the student became a dacoit, and anybody who was passing in the forest realms, he would go and cut off their fingers. He was collecting 1000 fingers. And Buddha was also happening to pass by, and when he came in touch with this Angulimala, his heart also got transformed, and even he became a disciple. So like this, Gautama Buddha was extremely powerful in the sense that, you know, his, as dint of his enlightenment, his renunciation, he just transformed anybody and everybody who came in touch with him. And when he left his body at the age of 80, attaining enlightenment, which he already did, the king at the time, his name was Raja Bhimbisa in the Magadha Rajya from the Mauryan Empire. Before that was Chandragupta Maurya. We know Chanakya Pandit, how he put Chandragupta on the throne. and later it was Raja Bimbisa, and then followed by Ajatashatru, and then came Ashoka, King Ashoka, Emperor Ashoka. And Ashoka was so greedy to become Samrat Ashoka, he was going and waging wars in so many different places, and when he happened to wage war against Kalinga, the present Orissa region and surrounding areas, because of this war, he saw that 1,000 soldiers were killed and something moved, shifted in the heart of Ashoka. He thought it was only because of his greed that such massive violence had taken place, thousands of people had given life. So Ashoka at that point, he embraced Buddhism. And not only he embraced Buddhism, all the terrains, regions that he was the king of, which was quite a lot actually, in the northern India, southern India, and many different places, the map was very different at the time. He declared Buddhism as the state religion. So Buddhism became highly prevalent, and Ashoka's son and daughter Mahendra and Sangamitra, he sent them to Sri Lanka to preach Buddhism there also. So Myanmar, Thailand, India, many many different places, Buddhism just spread like wildfire for a really long time. And then came Adi Shankaracharya, of course it's a whole another pastime by itself, where he established another kind of philosophy, so we will not go into all those details. So this is briefly about the two Buddhas, the Buddha whose incarnation is predicted in Srimad Bhagavatam and Dashavatara Stotra, and the second Buddha is our Gautama Buddha, whose story also I have described. And what does Buddhism talk about? It's Shunyavada. They say everything comes from zero and everything goes back to zero. Shunya means zero, Shunyavada. And whatever philosophical principles that they talk about is not really religion, because they don't really touch upon God per se. They only talk about sub-religious principles, like Prabhupada says, about, you know, being honest and being non-violent, ahimsa, paramo, dharmaha. They have the eightfold teachings, samyak drishti, samyak sankalpa, samyak vak, like that, eight different things. And basically it also talks about four truths, about dukkha, suffering, what is the origin of suffering, how to eradicate suffering. So these are some principal teachings of Buddhism. So Shunyavada is not really a authorized philosophy, religious philosophy that one needs to accept. In fact, that is why my spiritual master Srila Prabhupada, in his Guru Pranama Mantra, we say Nirvishesha Shunyavadi Paschatya Desha Tarine. That's the last line. He came, one of the things he did was eradicate Shunyavada, voidism. Okay, so this is briefly about the Buddha Avatara. So as we always do, let us sing the specific stotra related to this from Gita Govinda, Sri Jayadeva Goswami's Dashavatara Stotra. Nindasi Agnya Vide Keshava Ahaha Shruti Jatam Keshava. Nindasi Agnya Vide Keshava Ahaha Shruti Jatam. सदय हृदय दर्शित पशुगातम् सदय हृदय दर्शित पशुगातम् केशवादृत बुद्ध शरीरा केशवादृत बुद्ध शरीरा जय जगदीश हरे केशव जय जगदीश हरे. So I hope you are enjoying this series. Now we are left with just one more episode to cover the Dashavatara series, the 10th incarnation. Very very interesting incarnation about Kalki Avatara. I have lot of interesting information to share on that. But let me tell you, it's becoming little more, you know, it's taxing on my time to be able to do three episodes of Once Upon a Time in a week. So what I'm going to do is we will just have one episode going forward per week for Once Upon a Time, and that's going to be on Fridays. So we will still premiere the Once Upon a Time episodes, but only one per week, and that's going to happen on Fridays at 8 p.m. But don't worry, we will be giving you a lot of other exciting content, so you can look forward to know what those are going to be. But for now, please make note of this. So it's not going to be every Monday, Wednesday and Friday. It will be only on Fridays. Okay, so I hope you relished the incarnation of Buddha. So we will be back again to talk about Kalki Avatara. And meanwhile, if you haven't already subscribed to Aradhana YouTube channel, do that right now. And we also have an exclusive WhatsApp group for Once Upon a Time. I hope you join the group so you get notifications and updates from me. I will leave the link for that in the description, clicking which you can directly land on our WhatsApp group. So that's it for now. We will be back again. Take care. Hare Krishna.